having me and coming out in the middle of a Saturday. I don't think I've ever given a talk in the middle of the day on a Saturday. And so the video you've been watching, maybe we'll lay a little context for some of the work I'm going to show. And I guess the material, the work that I use as an artist is not conventional, perhaps. I consider the material to basically be the social systems that that we all move through, the social behaviors and the social codes. And I recognize this material, as all artists do, as a malleable material, as something that's constructed by people together. It's not something that is fixed. And much of my work happens in public space and with lots of different participants and collaborators. And I consider, again, all of the people that I work with to be part of the material of the work. And I'll kind of frame that, you know, specifically when I'm in a kind of university context and I teach in a university, I'll frame that throughout the work. So we got, so we can sort of transpose the frame of the work that I'm doing over, you know, the history of how art has been produced. So anyway, so this particular video, I'll give you the context for it, and context is very important for how I work. So I was invited to be in an exhibition at an art center. I won this award in Pittsburgh. I was the Artist of the Year, which is a strange thing in Pittsburgh because it's a small city. So to be the Artist of the Year there is, I mean, it's wonderful, but also kind of like, whoop. But anyway, so there's an art center about a mile and a half from my home in which the exhibition would be. And it's in an old mansion, beautiful neighborhood. And I was curious to think about the space between where I live and where the exhibition would occur. And to so I walked to the exhibition site just to go check it out. And as you always do, as you walk through a neighborhood, you look into people's homes, you imagine what their lives are like. And I decided, well, maybe I'll make a video, and which is what you're seeing, in which I literally tunnel through the homes of every neighbor between my house and the exhibition site. So what you're looking at is the homes of 50 different people who've who decided to participate. And it goes linearly from, we're now getting pretty close to the museum. This is in the basement of someone's home. And what happens is it's a series of almost like still lives, you know, these kind of miniature vignettes or movies, both banal and intimate. And, you know, I wanted to create this like third space, this psychological space that makes things that are private public, which is a trope that I think I use in much of the work. And eventually you work your way into the actual exhibition space. I can just kind of take you. There you go. And then the way the video works is it hits this point in the gallery, and then it just works all the way back. And then it goes all the way to my house and my daughter's feet there on the couch. And then it just bounces back and forth and back and forth. This is dizzy here, woo. Okay, it's actually not like that at all. It's supposed to be an incredibly slow and meditative experience. So, let me get out of this. Ooh, my computer is, here we go. So, and one of the themes besides this idea of the world as the material or the context or the social conditions as material is this, for me, exploring the distance between things. It's the distance between who you think you are and who you present yourself publicly to the world, the distance between yourself and the people who are part of your family, the distance between your family and other families, your group and association between others, nations. The distance between everything is a really interesting space for me as an artist to explore, sometimes collapse, sometimes collide, and see what occurs. And the first project I'm going to talk about articulates a much vaster distance than, you know, just between my house and the art center a mile and a half away. This is between Pittsburgh and Shanghai. So I was invited to be part of the Shanghai Art Biennial, which is every couple years they invite international artists to exhibit. And one of the interesting things about the biennial that year was it invited not just countries, but cities. So they invited also some off the beat cities such as Pittsburgh to be represented. And I was fortunate enough to be selected to be the artist to represent the city of Pittsburgh in Shanghai. Already a very strange sentence to imagine, you know, what that would be like. And additionally, the exhibition was going to be held in an old department store in the Bund in Shanghai, which is a very busy business shopping district. So knowing all of that, I decided to do this. So Pittsburgh has the largest per capita rate of elderly people in the city, next to Dade County, Florida. And part of that is because a lot of the folks who grew up there and still live there had their kids leave, right, in the 70s and the 80s when the mills were gone, kind of like, you know, some areas out here. And so you have young folks and you have older folks. And it's a really interesting dynamic in that every weekend there's a ton of estate sales. And so I went to an estate seller and I said, I want you to just key me in when you have a sale each week. And if you find a family that's multi-generation, that wants to get rid, that wants to get rid of absolutely everything, just let me know. And they found this family, the Lavasic family. It's a working class family. It's been in Pittsburgh for generations. And the parents had died and the kids had moved away and they basically wanted to get rid of everything. And it's an interesting moment in American public life where, you know, someone dies and this consumer skin that we've accumulated throughout a lifetime of buying is left over, you know, like a second body. And the question with this body is what's to be done with it? And, you know, and what does it mean when it's either disposed of or sold again? And, you know, I was interested in the kind of culture we have around family, even around death in the United States and even particularly in my city. And the stories that are embedded in people's lives and through their objects. So what I did was I bought this entire estate and I had the estate seller set it up as an estate sale. So, and price every single object. And then I documented the entire estate and I shipped it to Shanghai. And then we, so here's the, you know, without any of the possessions, it's just the skin of the architecture. And so then we set up, the exhibition was 3 months long. And the way the exhibition worked was we set up identical to the home, we set the objects up in the exhibition. So without the walls, obviously, of the home. So you walk into this very large room and there's room after room reconstructed of this estate sale from a Pittsburgh family in an old department store in Shanghai. And one of the very important things to note is that over half of the objects in the estate sale were originally made in China, right? So one of the, so the estate sale opens, and in many ways what happens through this project is these objects get repatriated. We hold the estate sale during the 3 months of the exhibition. And so slowly the exhibition disappears into the lives of people in Shanghai. And so, and this is sort of that collision of space, collision of the idea of family, you know, in Shanghai or in China, much of China, you know, your parents and your grandparents and your kids and grandkids all live together. People don't accumulate stuff, this much stuff, over this many generations. So there was a kind of anomalous feeling when they walked from the, you know, Tehran gallery, which had paintings, into this Pittsburgh gallery, which has stuff for sale. And, but the thing is that, you know, people in China are just getting used to sort of art exhibitions, but they're very used to capitalism and consumerism, because there's all this new state-run, you know, consumer culture, especially in Shanghai. And so people had no problem sort of turning on their hat that said, you know, I can buy this stuff. And again, there was a kind of weird fetish value to a lot of these objects. These are things, you know, that are made for a very American market. Now, this was definitely made in China. But, you know, people in China had never seen it before. And so their interest in the object was twofold. One is it's this artwork. Two, it's this object of production from our own country. This guy on the right actually tried to buy the entire estate on the open night. So one of the things, listen, a lot of the projects I set up as structures for me to learn about human behavior and experience the work as it occurs. So I had no idea how this would really play out. The first week, we had to put a limit on the number of objects that could be sold, because we would have sold out within 2 weeks of the exhibition, which was an interesting kind of tension, right? Where people were coming up, they're bringing five things, and we're saying, choose one. It's a, you know, you have to pick one, and it has to be under a certain price point, and you can come back when you want the more expensive items. And then additionally, there was this really lovely portrait of place that got transposed into Shanghai. The family, the Lavasics, owned a store, and in their store window, they had little train sets set up. They're a deeply Catholic family, which many Pittsburghers are, and so a lot of the sort of you know, residue of that was sold off into China, where religion, you know, has a different narrative within the state politic. There were some slides from the family, and a lot of the objects that were in the exhibition were in the slideshow. You get to see the family kind of inhabiting, you know, these objects, and recognize that there's this moment in which they go from one odor to another, where they sit in limbo, but you know, once they find a new home, all of a sudden new narratives start to accrue upon them. And I was interested in the old narrative still kind of existing, that there's a kind of residue of the object stories that got carried forth. So one of the things I asked folks to do is take photos after they bought an object and where they put it into their home, so how it's sort of recontextualized. It's a pill container. This is an old sewing machine that was broken, and this woman bought it. She emailed me. She said she fixed it and is using it in her business. This woman bought the Lavasics estate's their mailbox. This curator actually bought the family photo and placed it next to her family photo, which I thought was a really, like, the whole show was for that moment to occur. Slides misplaced. So here's another project in, this time the context is Porto Alegre, Brazil, and another kind of art biennial thing. And, you know, I'm interested in, you know, I work with art institutions, but I try to work with them as public spaces or as supporters of projects that happen in public space. And so this is a project that happens in the main park of Porto Alegre, and there's a lake you can see there. And I'll walk you through the experience that anyone would have during the 5 weeks of the exhibition. You'd walk in, and in Portuguese, it would announce that there are these free rides with Barack Obama or Hugo Chavez. And this is when Chavez was still alive. He's the, you know, the former president of Venezuela. And so then when people would line up, normally on a nice day, the parks are very well used, and people would take these rides in these swan boats. And we created our own version of the sign they usually have. So on the far right, you could take a free ride as long as you took it with Barack Obama or Hugo Chavez. And this is a project I did with Don Waleski, another artist. And so the way this works is we hired lookalikes, or as close as we could get in Brazil with the amount of money we had available to us. Of Chavez and Obama, and we chose Chavez and Obama because they kind of represent these political poles within, you know, Brazilian politics, between, you know, a lot of the socialist ideals that are coming out of Latin America, which are important to many Brazilians, and the strong relationship to, you know, the International Monetary Fund and the United States and a growing economy. And I think Brazil is challenged to kind of deal with those two dynamics. So that is the kind of larger geopolitical context, right? A social condition. But then we're in a kind of place of leisure and fun. And so we insert this kind of political theater into that. And the way it works is you could take a ride, kind of a romantic ride with Barack Obama. And he, during that ride, will ask you the question all lovers ask at one point. What do you think of me? And he has a little tape recorder, and as you tell him what you think of him, he records it. And Chavez does the same. He's very charismatic. And then in the afternoon, they both give public speeches based on the exact viewpoints the Brazilian public had of them. So they turn them from, you know, I think you are, to I am statements. And they speak for hours on end. And you can see there's Chavez in the background. And there's speakers all around the plaza, so you can hear Obama or Chavez, depending on where you are. And they're saying things that are remarkable. They're things you really wish politicians would say. And the reason is because it's actual, the public are saying them. And essentially what they become are these very particular devices to amplify the viewpoints of the Brazilian public about Chavez and Obama, but also about Brazil itself. Oftentimes they talk about their own issues and their own concerns. This is another project. This started actually out of, I teach at Carnegie Mellon University in the School of Art, and I started teaching, when I moved to the city, teaching in different storefronts, just locate my students in an empty storefront, so we have plenty of them, and we would just create culture out of the pre-existing, you know, kind of context. And this project came out of that, and then I sort of ran with it. It was called The Waffle Shop. The very first semester I did this with students, we decided to have a waffle shop, and mostly because right next to us is a really busy hip-hop nightclub. And in the middle of the night, there's nowhere to eat in the city. And the guy who owned the club said, man, I've got a waffle iron. If you sold waffles, you'd get people into your cockamamie, you know, storefront to participate in your weird art experiment. And we were like, okay. So we decided originally we would be a waffle shop reality show. So people would walk in, we had cameras assaulting them. It was really obnoxious and awful, and it's sort of socially what you shouldn't do with people if you want to get them involved. And then the next semester, I decided to end the class and just continue the project, but this time as a talk show. And so the way it works is, originally we're open like 11 p.m. till 3 a.m. in the morning on Friday and Saturday, which is when all the people from the nightclub were already drunk and, you know, open-minded, they've been dancing. They might come in, they're hungry. We eventually opened for brunch, too. This project lasted for 4 years. It was an actual business in a full-functioning restaurant that had a live talk show in the back that invited anyone who walked in to be on it. And the idea was, how do you get Americans? And we live-streamed it on the internet, so it's always being videoed and streamed on our little website. So how do you get people to engage with each other who wouldn't normally do so, right? And, you know, the people from the table on the left and the people on the table on the right. I mean, listen, they might say pass the salt or whatnot, but by and large, you come in with your community and you go out with your community. We spend most of our lives within our own little subset. This is also about the distance between, right? And, you know, I was thinking, well, everyone knows how to behave on a talk show. Whether you've even been on one or not, surprisingly, everyone kind of like gets that vernacular. It's so common. And we would just coax people up to, you know, who came in the restaurant, maybe they're a little drunk or maybe they're just happy on sugar and fat. And they would basically get on stage with an absolute stranger and produce the content of this cockamamie art project. This is a kid from our neighborhood who was doing a show on basketball and Islam, like the confluence of basketball and Islam. And this is a Jewish woman from the local neighborhood I live in, Squirrel Hill, who came in for her birthday. She's got birthday candles on her glasses. She had no idea there was a talk show in this joint. She just wanted, her and her girlfriends came in, it was her birthday, and we coaxed, and she was great, amazing woman. She came on stage and just, these two are having at it. And it, you know, listen, we're videotaping it and we're streaming it, but sometimes there's like three people watching online. In some ways, the most important moment was this moment between them, as opposed to the kind of projected theatrical moment. There's no fourth wall, you know. The difference between stage and audience and funder and participant are completely erased. After 4 years, a lot of crazy stuff started to happen. So I'm going to show a video. We figured we had about over 10,000 people get on stage. And there's miles and miles of footage. And I'll show a little clip that gives a flavor. This This is almost like watching video. I'm going so fast. Okay, let me just share this clip.
I was the lion in the Wizard of Oz.
In jail.
In prison. I don't do anything else. I can do some stuff. I can be the lion from the Wizard of Oz in prison.
The first time I saw a light switch turn on,
you just thought it was like daytime all of a sudden.
I was like, what madness is this? That's what I used to talk like that. I don't talk like that much anymore. Right. But what madness, ye lore, hath brought before thee thine eyes. And then I just smash it into bits.
I saw Inception last week, and this is weirder.
Really?
Oh,
yeah. Wow.
Like, I feel like I'm in an Inception right now.
You know what? I have to say
Ellen
that.
Ellen Page built this world for me.
Yeah, I can't believe this exists, to be honest.
Many people can't believe that it exists. It's awesome that you can't believe that it exists and you're actually physically here.
This was on our bucket list.
Yes.
Yeah, because we've always drove past this waffle place and we're like, what is this waffle shop and why is it only open in the middle of the night? So.
Very cool. Christine and I don't know each other at all.
We met this morning.
Just this morning, yeah. Over waffles and coffee.
Uh-huh.
But now this is amazing.
It's definitely a nerd tree.
Someone to understand you like I do.
Chill with a waffle show with Matt Sandler.
This is my new friend Matt Sandler.
Did you rap clean?
No, because this is my life. This is what I do every day. So,
I agree with that.
I mean, I can't. You know,
rap is life, and life isn't always clean.
I can't bleep out my life.
I can't.
It is what it is.
I've tried bleeping out my life.
It's not fun.
People get annoyed.
Exactly.
What qualifies you to do this?
Knowing the right people.
Oh, you know these people that have
sort of. And being at the right place at the wrong time.
So they get a different host every night?
Yeah, sorry, my wife's calling me. I'm talking to you on the show.
So tonight, we're going to be talking about theories that conspiracize theories, also known as conspiracy theories. Think about where the word co comes from.
Co.
Co, C-O. And it can't stand alone. What do you need? You need a hyphen. Now think about, what's a hyphen? A hyphen is a minus sign. So you're already not working together. Really, you're saying, co, fuck you, I'm doing this on my own.
That's symbolic right there.
Right there, that's what you got talking about.
On a cupcake.
Now you got white frosting.
Break it down.
You got white frosting on what? On a black chocolate cupcake. Now what's in between the black chocolate cupcake and his ham?
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
The white.
Always in between the black cupcake
and his ham.
Musical theater prison. It was a prison for people who were involved in musical theater who went astray. We weren't that organized. We never really finished a show. We had a few acts, a few scenes into it.
Yeah.
And things would go south.
Right.
I think you have pretty eyes. I don't think people look at each other's eyes enough. I think people should like really look in their eyes, and not look in their eyes the cliche way of like looking them in the eyes when they're saying something. Like really look at all the little details and crap in your eyes. I know, it's right here, right? Yeah, it's more of like an eye pimple.
I feel like we all come from Africa, really, but I'll leave it at that. We're all African American.
Yeah. Now, how was that growing up?
Being black. was traumatic, I think. I think the hardest thing was when my school friends, my chums, at school.
Chums,
yes, because I was raised white, you know.
Right, oh, so like chums is the word.
Yeah, I'm like, my chums.
Chums is the word.
My chums at school would constantly make these off-color jokes, these references. These references. I might give you waffles, dude. You totally spit on them.
Okay.
These references to people of color as being less than them, or you know, spear shakers, those sorts of things. Spear shakers. And I grew up in a very rural area, but yeah. And that was really hard for me. I think.
Now, did you ever want to like just bring your spear out and let them know that you were?
Here's the thing.
Okay, goes on. Thank you. So, yeah, that's pretty good. One of the, you know, like the last two guys, they'd never met, right? And they're talking about race in really, like, you know, a sensitive topic. Can we talk about race anymore between white and black folks? And can you play, you know, how does a place give a sense of play or possibility? You know, certainly we see that on you know, like The Daily Show or other, you know, programs can play with difficult topics. But can we do that in public space with each other? You know, can art function as a platform to create zones where that can occur? And, you know, in many ways, you know, not all the topics were racially toned or, you know, or about politics or anything, but, you know, in many ways that's what this project kind of created, this very open space that was pretty playful, that anyone could occupy, you know, hopefully with ways that they wouldn't normally go about their version of themselves in public, right? That kind of protected version. So another idea of thinking about the distance between things and as being the material of the work. This is a project at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Denver, and this is a relatively recent building that was built by David Ajay, the amazing architect. And a lot of downtown Denver is like looking a little bit like this, if you've been there. I actually spent a lot of time there when I was younger. And I basically, you know, I'm interested in museums. I love museums. I think they're amazing places of attention and distribution. And but I also think that they're also just social systems amidst other social systems, and that we should not recognize that, or we should not perceive them as separate from our lives. And so basically the whole project happens between the space of this and the space of this. And this is the backyard of a family that raises homing pigeons. And they're part of a group that raises homing pigeons that I collaborated with for this project. And they gave me this backyard homing pigeon loft that I then put on the roof of the museum. The museum has a very popular cafe on its roof, so lots of people come up. And then I semi-camouflaged it into the David Ajay geometry. And that becomes a bit of a metaphor in that it's still its kind of clunky old self. You know, it's the 5C pigeon loft, but it's, you know, it's trying to work its way into the museum for a moment. And then the more important thing is that the pigeon group gave the museum a group of young pigeons to be responsible for training and taking care of. Now, one of the responsibilities museums have is to artworks, right? They're the caretakers. They're there to make sure that they're preserved, that they're appreciated, and that they last. Here, that contract becomes highly explicit, where now they have to clean up crap every day. They have to feed the work to make sure it stays alive. And not only does the institution have to participate in that, but now the viewers are also doing so. So if you come to the museum, you can choose one of the birds, and you can take it home with you. And over the course of a year, over 1,000 people took home birds. And the way in which homing pigeons are trained is you take them incrementally away from their home and release them, and they go back and they you know, that's the way they've sort of figured. I mean, there's other mechanisms, but and so thus, when you come to the museum and go home with a bird, you're participating in the training of the larger artwork itself, and you have a stake in it. I mean, it's interesting, you know, there's a loan program here where the artworks go into students' dorms. I think it's a wonderful idea to give them a stake in that artwork, because now when it goes back to the museum, they're like, yeah, I lived with that thing. You know, it's like, it's intimate to me. It's not this thing that's institutionally dislocated from my life. So here, the museum was amazing. Listen, this is a challenge for a museum to do. And they were, from top to bottom, involved in every aspect of it. We hired pigeoneers, who were people who would every day be responsible for taking care of the birds. But you'd also have to go down and check your bird out at the front desk. And we had, you know, a GIS map of where the pigeon had last gone, knowing that it can't go more than twice its last flight. And then getting all of your personal information, so we make sure we get our pigeon back. And letting you know when your pigeon arrives, you get an email when it comes back. So you take your pigeon home, and you live with it for a couple of days. And in essence, what happens now is that the exhibition space goes from being the museum to this domestic space. You have a part of the larger artwork, and you see yourself again as sort of part of an ecosystem of not only participation, but support. Like, there's a stake for a viewer to have in relationship to an artwork. Artworks don't exist on their own. There is a tree, does not make any sound if no one's around to hear it fall in the woods. So after a couple days, you just open your window and let your bird go. We ask people to take photos of some of their releases. And it's a really wonderful, simple, miraculous moment in which the space that you think of between yourself and the museum now just has to exist in your imagination of the flight of the bird back home. And there's a bit of trepidation and fear, like, you know, where's it going? It's now out of my sight. We didn't lose any birds, you'll be happy to know. They're remarkable creatures. And then they would home back in, we'd give them a call. And so there's a couple of other aspects to the project. One is that every morning, the birds would be given an exercise flight. So right in the morning, right before they get fed, they'd be let out to exercise. And, you know, you can imagine the project got some attention in the city, and you could look up in the sky in the morning at around 10 a.m. and you would see the artwork sort of escaped from the institution, you know, flying up into the sky. Or maybe they're just some pigeons, which to me is like the beauty of the work, is that all pigeons get implicated as being potentially part of the project. And they're very much, you know, the species we pay the least attention to. And then the work, almost like an additive sculpture, as the circumference, the navigational capacity, and the homes they visited gets larger and larger, you know, the pigeons can fly up to 500 miles. And in essence, they map the sort of participation in the work itself. This is a project I still continue to do, and it's called The Last Billboard. And it's on top of the building that I used to run that waffle shop project in, and it's essentially a very dumb analog billboard made out of old-fashioned wooden letters. It's like the complete inverse of social media. It lasts for a month, and I curate it, inviting artists, this is Anthony DeCenza, a San Francisco artist, to create works that can exist in our city. It's really easy. As a curator, all I have to do is email someone, and they email me something back. And I was really interested in the context of text and advertising and what we sort of expect in our public space. Most, you know, texts and words that we see have this really didactic function, like storefront for rent, you know, bus stop, Carnegie Library, direction, and then this. You know, I wanted to open that space of advertising up to a space that's much more curious and open. This is artist Mark Horowitz. The previous one was Nina Kechadorian. Mark got a lot of crazy calls that week, or that month. This is an 11-year-old girl, the daughter of a friend of mine, who was wrestling with issues of, you know, when did skinny become fashionable? And she wanted to create a blog about it. I thought those were interesting questions. This is text that usually exists in the public realm, decontextualized into a sort of form of poetry by Matt Shane. This is Adam Fralin, amazing sculptor. He calls this piece crier, like the town crier, but also a baby crying and also a mourner crying. It's a really beautiful, lovely work. This is a former student of mine sent me this, right? This might be generational. But this is, you know, your text auto-correcting one word into another word again and again and again. And what it was interesting, so, you know, we align this flush right because that's the way it looks on your text. It's something that has like one relationship to you in your life, and it sort of passes through like, oh, you know, fuck, 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 duck, 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 duck. And then putting it up here for a month and seeing it every day, it becomes almost a monument to that like tiny little moment in time. So I'm going to show that project you were laughing at earlier, which is the Conflict Kitchen. So this has actually been going on for 5 years, and I co-direct it with Don Waleski. And the Conflict Kitchen is an actual restaurant artwork that sells food from countries the United States is in conflict with on a rotating basis. And I'm going to show one of the interesting things is how the narrative of this work has spiraled outside of just our local eatery into lots of different discourses, and how people have come to know the project through different lenses. And this is basically a compilation of kind of media about the project. And then I'll go into the details of how it actually works.
Die USA sind in viele Konflikte verwickelt, ob militärisch wie noch bis vor kurzem in Irak, als Schutzmacht für Israel im Nahen Osten oder ideologisch verfeindet wie etwa mit Nordkorea, Venezuela oder Kuba. Diese Länder kennen viele Amerikaner nur als Bösewichte aus den Fernsehnachrichten. Das Takeaway-Restaurant Conflict Kitchen setzt da den Kochlöffel an und serviert wechselnde Menüs aus genau solchen Ländern.
التجربة هو خلق جو موات لمناقشة ثقافات الشعوب وسياسة الخارجية الأمريكية.
L'idea di attirare i clienti con del buon cibo per poi coinvolgere in eventi o dibattiti mirati a stimolare proprio la conoscenza della cultura e della politica di alcuni stati come per esempio l'Iran, l'Iraq, Cuba, Venezuela e la Corea del Nord.
ويبدو أن فكرة المطعم تجاوزت ذلك بتوظيفها الطعام لإضفاء مسحة إنسانية على الحروب والنزاعات.
So you order Iranian food or Persian food anywhere from $5 to $8, and they give it to you wrapped up in a wrapper that has conversations from people that are in that country.
It features the opinions of Palestinians living on the West Bank and in the United States.
Wenn seine Köstlichkeiten auspackt, dann erfährt man etwas über Afghanistan, zum Beispiel, was ist die aktuelle Regierung oder was sind die Rechte der Frauen. Eine Art kulinarische Völkerverständigung.
I think what they do is fantastic. They inform people about issues that are otherwise unknown in the United States.
Viele Leute denken, wir Afghanen sind Terroristen, vor allem nach den Anschlägen des 11. September. Aber unser Land entwickelt sich weiter und das ist toll, dass man das hier lernen kann.
And you know, the country is still thriving.
الشعب الامريكي بشكل عام شعب طيب شعب ترى بحاول بس يتعرف على شو اللي موجود في النزاع ما بين الفلسطينيين والاسرائيليين هذه كانت لهم فرصه انهم يشوفوا من طريقه ثانيه غير عن الميديا العاديه اللي بيشوفوها على التلفزيون.
Meine Mutter kommt aus Nordkorea. Ich finde es eine fantastische Idee, den Menschen hier dieses Land über das Essen näher zu bringen. So kann man mit Freunden und Kollegen gleichzeitig darüber reden, was dort passiert. Das ist toll.
I think it's really important that the Conflict Kitchen has created a space where we can have an exchange of ideas.
In a way, it inspires me to speak out more because I feel like I have to channel that fear that we all have, the collective fear, and just channel it into positivity and show that we are united.
So that's a kind of introduction from one perspective, and then I'll give you a more kind of behind the scenes and how things work on a daily basis. So the project actually started out of the same kitchen I was running the waffle shop from. And it started as a little takeout joint on the side. So I was actually running two restaurants that competed with each other. One was this waffle shop that had a talk show, and the other was this little side takeout joint that sold food from originally Iran. And the idea was, our designer, there's a lot of aspects to these works. And I'll just mention our designer is Brett Yasko, who's actually the designer for Mass Mocha. He does all their books now, but he was designing all their stuff before. He lives in Pittsburgh. And so there's lots of kind of stories or seductions or levels in which you could sort of participate or understand this project. One is just our mere existence. You know, the idea that in Pittsburgh, which has never had an Iranian, never had an Afghan, never had a Venezuelan, never had a Cuban, never had a Palestinian restaurant in its history, we're putting these onto the culinary landscape. Number two, there's this, you know, kind of privileging of languages that are not our own. You know, the text is, you know, in Farsi or in Dari or in Spanish. And then there's this visual anomaly, right? We're not trying to blend in this project. We want to stand out. The only thing we do blend in is that we're right on the street. This is not an academic project. This is a project that happens right in the middle of daily life, 7 days a week. So we're open from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. every single day of the week for the past 5 years. It's not a pop-up, and it's very important that I say that for folks. It's part of our interest in this work is becoming part of the fabric of our city, of changing the way in which we think and talk about places, and more specifically, people that we might not know much about, things that are often uncomfortable for us to talk about. So our first version was Iranian. We've worked on other versions. This is actually our chef, Robert Serre. We went to Cuba, cooked in a lot of people's homes. The best way to travel is just cook in people's homes, especially since all I do is eat, and he does all the cooking with all the other chefs. And then initially, all the food was sold with this wrapper that had interviews from people in that country. So Iranians, all their viewpoints on a variety of topics. And the idea was to use these interviews as a way of complicating how Americans see how Iranians think, right? Rather than seeing a headline about a governmental policy, they're reading all personal opinions from Iranians who often disagree on any one topic, just as we would all disagree on any topic here. These are some of the sort of the categories that would come out. So the food becomes this dissemination point, right? It becomes this vehicle to get these stories out into the public. Obviously, the food itself and its ingredients and, you know, the flavors create, you know, a sensory relationship to a culture. And that's pretty common in America. Immigrants introduce themselves to you know, cities all the time by opening up restaurants, but it wasn't happening in our city. And then there's this point of contact, which is very performative, where our employees are interacting with the public and trying to make what's uncomfortable comfortable again. Again, this is sort of almost taking the talk show onto the street. This is our Venezuelan version. Again, traveling in Cuba. I'm going to go relatively quickly. So besides the food and a variety of publications that we hand out, we do events. This is a live Skype meal between Pittsburgh and Tehran, in which here we are in Pittsburgh and here we are in Tehran, sharing a dinner party across a table. This is another version. So this is in Pittsburgh and this is in Tehran. And we're making the same Persian recipes. One of the interesting things is that this was during the height of the most recent round of sanctions, and many of the Iranians had to buy like kind of cheap versions of the food at the market, where we had the privilege of making everything from scratch. So what happened was, what happens at any dinner party, an open discussion occurs. And what we're doing is just creating a platform for that. We now do education. We're developing curriculum for area schools and colleges who either come to us or we go to them. This is a live Skype cooking lesson between Leila El-Haddad, who wrote the Gaza Kitchen Cookbook. She was on Anthony Bourdain's show, and a local school. One of the things, you know, the home ec that lots of us grew up with, that doesn't exist. Those kitchens are still there, but no one does, you know, what's called home ec or whatever, or is learning about food even through making. But some of those rooms exist. And we actually have reoccupied those rooms and are using them as classrooms. Festivals, this is a local Iranian festival. And recently, 2.5 years ago, we moved to the central public plaza of the city. So we're across from the main public library, between the two universities. We have 200 to 300 people who come a day. We're getting a lot of folks who would never think about, say, Iran, engaging with us. And we've become a kind of very interesting dissemination point for lots of, you know, information. You know, how Afghans are thinking about Americans during the last Afghan election. We try to be, you know, right now we're focusing on Cuba as Cuban relations are starting to change, right? We're about to focus on Iran again. So we're trying to be the place that kind of unpacks what's going on in the news in a different way. There's a publication of interviews with children from Afghanistan, and to give perspectives that you might not often hear. This is another kind of initiative we do called The Foreigner. It's a weekly event. I don't know what the hell. I guess an event. It's a performance. So the way it works, I'll walk you through it. You're ordering your Iranian food, and our server will say, hey, you can have your lunch with Sohrab. He's currently living in Iran. And you can have it through the body of Elise. You know, she works here usually in the window, and she's just around the corner. And Elise is live connected to Sohrab through these headphones. Sohrab speaks English. And anything he says, she repeats. And then the customer has a little microphone, and anything the customer says, Sohrab hears in Iran. So Elise is this sort of human avatar. And in many ways, a metaphor for the larger project. She's someone who's local and familiar. You've seen her at the restaurant. And now she's literally embodying the voice of this man in Tehran. And not only is sort of this idea of foreign and local confused, but gender, oftentimes race. And that to us and to me is a very interesting place for art to occupy. A space of ambiguity, a space where identities start to break down. I mean, we're really great about saying who we are and who we are not. But I think, you know, the most interesting places are when that gets destabilized a bit. So I'll show, I think I have a video. This is, I did this in Cleveland in public spaces. So on the right are the Iranians and on the left are their avatars in public venues. We did it in San Diego. Alex, this is at the San Diego Museum in the Persian galleries. We do something called the Iranian speech and then the Cuban speech where we crowdsource, ask Cubans to write a speech that they would like Barack Obama to deliver. And then we hired the number one Barack Obama impersonator, this guy here. And this is 2 years ago. This is before anyone had a whiff of what was going to be happening in Cuba. So I'll give you a little clip. So basically, we hired him. He's reading the exact speech written for him by some Cubans. And then we play it at the restaurant itself on a monitor. There's an excerpt.
I actually forget the last time I had anything to say about Cuba. And I find that upsetting. We like to talk a lot about defending human rights. But then we have trade and have close ties to China and Vietnam and Russia. Just imagine if the United States had to exist for a week under the Cuban regime. We would eliminate so many American problems. I firmly believe that we should return Guantanamo Bay to Cuba. I mean, even the British returned Gibraltar to Spain. It is outrageous for us to have prisoners there. The only reason Bush sent prisoners from Iraq to Cuba is to torture them in Cuba. Now, there is a Cuban woman I know in Miami that never worked a day in her life, and she gets Social Security. And I say, whoa, this is not fair. But our government does it. This is how those guys in Florida get elected all the time. I mean, why else would new Cuban Americans vote for Republicans? Because they're poor? No poor person is a Republican.
So, as you can see, those opinions kind of vary. It's not one perspective on Cuba, it's a multiplicity of perspectives from Cubans about Cuba that they'd like to hear an American president say. And, you know, ironically, he said half of the things, 2 years later. So we also do lunch hours, events where we invite experts or expats from various communities. There's a Syrian doctor in Pittsburgh who's been going to Syria for a long time, since the war started. our Sudanese population, Egyptian, veterans of the Afghan War. So a lot of southwestern PA has a lot of veterans. So people who had, you know, experience in Afghanistan, also talking with Afghans. We did a North Korean version of the project, which we basically developed by going to South Korea and working with North Korean defectors, cooking recipes. I'm gonna go kind of. We did a live cooking lesson from a North Korean chef with home chefs all over the world on the bottom of the screen. So everyone got the same recipe and we all cooked together online. We went to Palestine a year and a half ago, right before the last war in Gaza, and cooked there throughout the West Bank, parts of Israel where we worked with, you know, Arab Israelis. And this makluba, it's a very famous dish that, this is a taboon? I'm getting the name wrong. This is basically like a community oven in a neighborhood that's all over the West Bank where people collectively share the oven and cook in it and maintain it. Obviously, well, you know, what's going on throughout the West Bank is quite difficult for the lives of Palestinians. And you know, experiencing that firsthand was, you know, although I knew about it, was still quite eye-opening. This is a family in Hebron who made us this dish, and then in the afternoon we went with their son down to the mosque, which is the Tomb of Abraham, right? So it's split as a mosque and a synagogue. Very contentious area, as you might imagine. And what happened is in his neighborhood, there was this roving checkpoint, and this little poor seven-year-old boy is terrified of the Israeli soldiers. His father didn't have his ID with him. We had to go get our car. We had to get the car to bring them in because they would have been detained overnight if they didn't have the ID. So just sort of daily life is impacted by the occupation in every way. And the ramifications of that, you know, we see. So this is a man whose fields were just destroyed by the settlers who are living in this situation, which water from his property is actually goes under his land into the settlement. So a lot of different, this is a woman, we actually bought all the olive oil from her and her sister. We found them literally while we were driving down the road, there was this sort of anti-Arab graffiti, and we met them. They've lived there generations since the Ottoman times, and they're just trying to basically maintain their presence, and everyone offers you tea, of course. A family in Nablus, kanafa, which is the most amazing food you might ever come across. Bedouins. So anyway, so I'm giving a sense of kind of how the research process goes. And then we open, we invite the local Palestinian community from our city for a taste testing. My friend Ahmed, his mom actually was visiting from Gaza. And she, of course, told the chef exactly what he was doing wrong in the recipes, which any mother who walks in, who's Iranian or Cuban or anything, was always something we're doing a little bit wrong, which is good. We can always improve. And then, you know, we open, we as a book of interviews with kids from the West Bank and Gaza. We sold the olive oil with some information from the farmers. We did the foreigner again. Here, I'll give you a very quick clip. This is Tracy here on the right, who is embodying Mohammed. Mohammed was our guide throughout the West Bank. And she's available there for people to talk to. You can kind of hear Mohammed's voice in the background a little bit.
And also the Islamic State is on the move. Is that a threat to you or is that too far away?
First of all, those are not Muslims.
No.
They're disguising themselves as Muslims, but they are mercenaries.
Oh, okay.
They are mercenaries. They're not doing the work for Allah. So what about you? I still think you're young, I believe so.
Yes.
But what do you think about the future? Are you going to get married, a Middle East guy? Or someone from...
I think my parents would want me to marry an Indian Muslim guy like myself.
I believe that your parents are looking for a good future for you. You know, they're worried about you. And they want you to have a good life for you.
Yes.
But don't just... take it easy with them.
Okay.
Because they're always thinking it and they're always caring about you.
Thank you.
So it's an interesting project in that, or that particular performance, in that it's kind of awkward at times and it's kind of intimate at times. And, you know, it's also, Tracy's amazing. She's super empathic and lovely. And actually, Muhammad's like a little brusque. And like his brusque fatherliness is sort of transmuted through her, you know, compassion. And but in the end, it's this combo package, right? It's a bit of America and it's a bit of Palestine simultaneously. So just very briefly, you know, we opened our Palestinian version and we came under criticism from some local Jewish organizations that felt that we should also be focusing on Israel, that we should be presenting an Israeli perspective as well as a Palestinian. Now, we've never come under, you know, we never had this sort of criticism for any of our other versions. You know, North Korean never asked for South Korean perspective, and Cuba never asked for Iran or American perspective. And listen, I'm Jewish, I understand the dynamics at play, but you know, our goal is to present a Palestinian voice in American public life, and frankly, it barely exists. The narrative about what's going on over there is pretty much driven by policy that's coming out of Israel. And so our idea was to humanize the Palestinian voice and perspective, and then you know, you're welcome to go from there. Unfortunately, the local Jewish Federation decided they didn't really like that. So they went to the newspapers, they went to my dean, they went to the president of my university, they went to my partners, and he said, you need to close this place down because it's anti-Israeli. Well, you know, most Palestinians, listen, are not on board with much Israeli policy. But the project is more about focusing on a Palestinian perspective and culture. So there was, some call its new focus one-sided, anti-Israeli, which is fine. It's a public project. I think criticism is welcome. You know, the public was incredibly interested and curious and supportive of the project. The Federation started tweeting and putting out things such as this, that we says the Conflict Kitchen uses quotes calling for the death of Israelis and Jews, which to me was personally offensive because there's nothing further from the truth than what I would actually ever do in my life. And then some papers picked it up. This is actually Jerusalem Post. U.S. Jews, now it's, I guess, including myself, outraged over Pittsburgh restaurant's Palestinian menu. Now, this is fine. And again, I recognize that this is a very hot topic and people are going to use it to discuss issues that are important to them. The Heinz Endowments, which is a local foundation which gave us some money to move to a new location. To be clear, 95% of our operating funds come from people buying food. So that's how we really support ourselves. But the Heinz gave it, they're a great progressive organization. And what happened was, you know, Secretary of State John Kerry is married to Teresa Heinz. She's the trustee of the foundation. And Fox News did their little thing. Now we're an anti-Israeli eatery. Restaurant, and then Breitbart got a hold of it, and now John Kerry's wife funds radical anti-US, anti-Israeli eatery. I'm sure she nor John Kerry have any idea who we are, although they did, unfortunately, after this came out. And 1 week later, B'nai B'rith, which is a great organization, does a lot of good in the world, but they decided to ask the Heinz Endowments to disavow their support to Conflict Kitchen. And the Heinz Endowments did, under the political pressure and lobbying pressure. They said that it appears to be terribly at odds with the mission of promoting understanding. Now, this is an organization that gave us a grant because we're an internationally recognized local project that has promoted understanding about countries and cultures for 5 years, except when it comes to Palestine, it's a different issue. And 1 week later, we received a death threat in the mail and had to close the restaurant, which became a kind of, which was an interesting pivot point in the narrative of what was going on. Because now, in many ways, what's happening in the region and what's happening throughout the United States became very explicit in our own city. And we closed, we worked with the FBI and the Counterterrorism Task Force, and we figured all it out. While we were closed, one of the interesting things happened. People just started posting notes onto the facade of the restaurant in support. And, you know, our customers very much are our supporters, our funders. Some people come and they have no idea what we're doing, and some people are coming 3 days a week. There were rallies held out in front of the restaurant. And a kind of sea change of discourse occurred, in which people, we opened 1 week later after everything was sort of cleared, and we had basically a 24-hour police presence. And it became a much more political act just to get a falafel. And in many ways, that's fine. I think, you know, I certainly would never want to go through this again in my entire life. But the next weekend, we asked people to bring a Palestinian dish to get entry into a potluck. And 200 Pittsburghers, who had probably never cooked Palestinian food, showed up in support. And to discuss, essentially, you know, what are the issues at stake here in the United States itself, in being able to talk about Palestine. Lots of organizations decided to no longer support us. Fortunately, we have the autonomy to continue without them. One of the things that we started doing was we turned our Instagram account over to people who are living within the countries we're focusing on. So these are Palestinians who are uploading daily images from their life. This is, you know, excuse me, what we often are presented in the media as terror tunnels, the tunnels that Gaza, that are underneath Gaza that go through to Egypt or Israel, but also are economic tunnels. They're places in which people under siege, which has happened throughout history, use to actually keep produce coming in the byproduct of the war, and all, you know, as well as celebration of life. And currently, we're focusing on Cuba, so we've got some Cuban photographers who are taking pictures daily of their life. This is great. I like the comment. What's it? Wow, it's not even close to how I imagine Cuba. Let's go. I guess so. And tonight, well, we're in the middle of a film festival, so tonight actually is a screening. We're doing a free open public screening of Juan of the Dead, which is the Cuban zombie film. So Dawn of the Dead was filmed in Pittsburgh, if you guys don't know that. So this is like a nice symmetry. And part of the film festival is we have these paladars in people's homes where a local Cuban-American hosts the paladar, shows home movies from her family in Cuba, and then we just host a meal together. That's Dawn of the Dead. Oh, I think I'm out of time. I don't know if I should talk about the project with Mark. Okay, I'm gonna talk quickly. Ready? Here we go. So I'm working with Mark Allen from Machine Project and Sohrab Kashani from Sazmanab in Iran. I just went to Iran in June, and I got a grant to support this project to create a sitcom that's produced both in Iran, specifically in Tehran and in Los Angeles. And one of the things that's interesting is in Iran, they make knockoffs of American sitcoms. You wouldn't know that. This is a sort of version of Friends. They're even currently making a knockoff of Modern Family. It's almost scene to scene, except the gay family is not gay. And they have to, you know, there's all the sort of restrictions in Iran that they have to deal with. So there's this strange, you know, kind of inverse of culture. I mean, everyone in Iran knows everything about American culture. We know practically nothing about what's going on in Iran. So the idea is I'm going to be producing a sitcom that's shot in both cities, where a set of actors, basically the premise is it's one family that's stuck both in Tehran and in Los Angeles at the same time. They don't know it. It's like a science fiction. And so they speak back and forth to each other. So the Iranian actor mother would say something and it would be answered by the American version of the daughter. And it was all about basically constant miscommunication. And instead of this sort of paralysis we have where all we want to do is reinforce our viewpoints, it's like the improv idea of yes and, where every offer that's given to you, no matter how absurd it is accepted and then furthered. And then it goes to some giddy, crazy, other third place where the narrative is collectively playful and we work together on something. So it's probably the first, I think, production that's ever happened between United States and Iranian set of actors and team. We'll see. There's some challenges. It'll be coming up. I think that's it. So, we've got the, anyone want the talking stick? I don't know if there's any questions. Yes, sir.
I would think that there is an argument to be made that Abrams is right, because weren't you just accepting a position of neutrality, which isn't a possible position? You weren't trying to do what you told us in the film. We weren't trying to do any even-handed presentation.
Agreed. Yes, it's not even-handed. We're presenting a Palestinian perspective. And sometimes a Palestinian perspective can be presented without an Israeli perspective. Just as often, I think, an Israeli perspective should be presented without always having a Palestinian one. There's often, you know, one of the interesting things, excuse me, is there's an Israeli Jewish film festival in our city. It's a great film festival. I've gone to it. We decided to create a Palestinian film festival. People from the Jewish Federation said, can you include Israeli Jewish perspectives? I said, well, could you do that with the Israeli Jewish Film Festival? And they're like, no, I see no need. And I said, you know what? You're right. You don't have to. You're presenting a very particular cultural perspective. And that said, of course, there's lots of places where the two overlap. But for me, and I'd say for the entire project, our goal is to present information that most Americans often don't come by about culture, about daily life within these countries. And for that version, we focused on Palestine.
Do you believe a Palestinian perspective was accurate?
I believe a Palestinian perspective is complicated, and there is no such thing as a singular Palestinian perspective.
Good for you.
Good for you. Sir.
How were the prices set in the estate sale in China?
You know, so that is a great question. We basically, this was a risk. We went right with what the estate seller in Pittsburgh set them at. And then we converted them to the UN. And I was concerned, like, that's going to be pricey for, you know, Chinese consumers. And nah. It was like we hit the price point was perfect. And that was kind of interesting also to just transpose those values. And it was, you know, there are certain things like an old Tom and Jerry doll, you know, like from the 70s, that the estate seller sold for maybe $3. And this one guy came, he's like, oh my God, it was like the Holy Grail. He would have paid hundreds, no doubt, for it. So value kind of shifts as well for certain objects. And then other things that might be valuable in the United States are, you know, are really crap for folks in China, so yeah.
Would you think of doing it on a smaller scale with Cuba?
Yeah, it'd be interesting in Cuba. I mean, yeah. Yeah, it would be interesting. One of the interesting things I didn't mention was, you know, in China, so we were actually gonna do a reverse. We were gonna bring a Chinese, there is no estate sales per se, but a similar type of situation back to the Warhol Museum. But the biennial kept all the money from the sales, right? Shocker. Yeah, it was crazy. We had no legal recourse too, because it's in China. They can make up whatever rules they want. So about like, it was about over $7,000 in sales just vanished into the air. So we weren't able to do a show coming back. Sorry, someone had a... Doing a lot of good in Pittsburgh? Depends on who you talk to. Some. Right there. That, yes.
So you said that one of your goals is to set up situations that become the fabric of the city in which you're located. And I was wondering if that's sort of a critique on works of social practice that don't do that. But sort of go to a place, create a situation, document it, and leave.
I don't know. I wouldn't. It's not a critique. I'm not creative. I don't make work out of like a sort of like, I'm not doing this, I'm doing that. It's more generally my interest and my experience has led me to wanting to make work in this way. And I recognize there's work that kind of does just, and perhaps when I talked about like the pop-up, that we're not a pop-up. I do, and listen, I think things should pop up, and I think sometimes they're incredibly effective. And I even think we were having a discussion about like Thomas Hirshhorn's recent project, the Gramsci monument that he, some people say, plopped down into it. I think it was the Bronx or, I actually like that project. I think it's really compelling. I think it's complicated. I think an artist can go into a community without having to know absolutely everything about it and having to be responsible for all of its, solving all of its social conditions. I also think an artist can be in a community that, you know, through their presence and their continued presence, they form relationships that they would have never imagined from the get-go. So I'm a person who thinks you can do everything from A to Z and it's all good. And it's really up to the artist to figure out the ethics and the criteria under which success is defined. There is a whole critique of, in which he used the term social practice. So it's a kind of a new term that's used in art now for artists who are working with social settings. It's become very popular. It's taught in schools now. And the critique of it is, you know, artists who are kind of going in as almost colonizers or, you know, thoughtless interlopers. And or doing works that seem to have some sort of social effect, but really they're just for the art world documentation. And I think all those critiques are probably justified, but I'd also say that you could say the same of all art in the same sentence. It's not exclusive to artists who are working in the social sphere, and that even working within an institution, an arts institution, is a social sphere. And you know, issues of ethics, colonization, and being an interloper, and who your audience is should still be valid and important. So it's complicated.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. Next. Thanks.
How do you source? You talked a little bit about the Obama and Chavez text and where that text comes from. I'm interested in where the Conflict Kitchen text comes from, and then also really interested in where the sitcom text.
Okay, this working backwards, the sitcom, we're gonna get writers, like I'm gonna be working with sitcom writers in LA and TV writers in Iran who are willing to work with me. All right, so there's a kind of subset there. Probably gonna be more experimental theater writers. The text for Conflict Kitchen comes from a lot of different sources. Oftentimes we travel and we're talking to cab drivers, to politicians, to school teachers, to kids, to anyone we can get our hands on. So there's that. And then the Obama text, in Cuba, the Cuban text came from our trip and then some key people we met who went out on the street and started interviewing folks. Cuba's actually ironically been the toughest in terms of, you know, like we can't do the Foreigner Project because the internet sucks. It's like literally the worst. And even the telephone's unstable. So a lot of, and getting, you know, we have video now that I had a guy in Cuba just shot of street scenes. And it was almost like impossible to get it here, you know. So it's often, depends on the situation. Afghanistan was also a little bit difficult, but yeah. I'm sorry. The other gentleman.
That's right, the segue
pass.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Do you have any plans to expand the Conflict Kitchen project outside of Pittsburgh?
Right.
I think that there might be an appetite for that kind of culinary diplomacy.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's there's already a place in London that's doing it that talked to us and we're like, go for it. And Tina and I were talking about this. I said, someone's going to ask me this question today at the lecture, which is totally cool. Which is like, you know, to be honest, it's I'm flattered you would even ask. So we get requests every day, every week, not every day, every week from people in countries. And I think the model probably won't be us franchising ourselves, which is really just complicated and difficult. We're running a business. I've got 20 employees. I think it'll be a more open source model where, you know, we give like the set of things we do and you can do them in your own way, modify them for your own situation if you think it's important, which is what we tell people already. But maybe we need to kind of formalize that a little bit more and make it more of a template. and just consult someone and get them off the ground, but I don't really want to be running. You know, to me, it's about the city I live in. It's a, you know, it's a mile away from my home. Yes.
Really love the waffle shop interviews. I wondered, had you put any on, or would you put any on YouTube?
They used to be on YouTube. Yeah, I don't. There's. I've got like bags of footage. If you want to go through it and start doing some, doing some editing. There's gems and all that. I mean, there's a lot of boring stuff as well. Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Tina.
I have a question. It's not that well thought out, but I have noticed in a lot of the projects that there is a kind of design sensibility that runs through them, and I definitely saw it in Conflict Kitchen, and I saw it even in your editing of the Waffle Shop videos. And I wondered if you could talk about that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it speaks to me to sort of some desire maybe around coherence or around aesthetics or around marketing.
Mm-hmm.
Could you say something about that?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty conscious. I mean, I went to design school for a little bit, so I'm super conscious about design and the kind of the aesthetics and vernaculars that I'm working with and within, right? There's languages in each situation that sometimes I modify accordingly. You know, I sometimes people say the work's too tight in that way. And, you know, taking Hirshhorn as an example, I mean, it's like, although I'd say that's a pretty tight aesthetic. So yeah, I mean, I think about it all the time. I think about how something's presented. I think about the marketing and branding. I don't use those terms, but essentially that's what we're doing. I talked about how people enter the work. So these, listen, I'm not in an art museum most of the time. I'm just in the public, and I need to get an idea across quickly and clearly. And so the presentation of what I'm doing needs to not confuse someone, and it needs to seduce them to some capacity. And so in that way, I'm hyper aware of the aesthetic. Even the Waffle Shop had this kind of like, you know, whatever, we played upon this like 50s aesthetic. And even the talk show idea for that came from Seinfeld, from this episode where Kramer finds the old Merv Griffin. You guys, who knows the Merv Griffin show? Yeah, Merv Griffin was a great show. That was like early talk show. He finds the old Merv Griffin talk show set in the dumpster, and he sets it up in his apartment. And then he has this, like, pretends he's having a talk show. There's no cameras. And so it's kind of that aesthetic I stole, more or less, and even that concept. So, yeah, I'm definitely, I think about that a lot. Yes?
I was wondering, for the projects where you're traveling, particularly Conflict Kitchen, I guess, how traveling as an artist has played out, like, do you run into difficulties? Are you questioned about what you're doing in certain places?
No. I mean, Cuba, no problem. Iran, no problem. I mean, those are really the only two places where it could have been a problem. Palestine, no problem at all, no. I mean, actually, the problem was going through Israeli security, asking us questions about whether we went to the West Bank and who we met with, and but not in Palestine. It was like people were so incredibly generous and open, and Iran was amazing. I mean, just, I don't know if people have traveled, but it's, you know, quite easy to go, and you know, one of the most American-loving countries I've been in, ironically, in terms of maybe not policy, but American culture. And you know, there are, listen, there are issues, there are restrictions, there are things you should be smart about doing and not doing. But no, it hasn't been a problem. Yes?
I'm interested in the afterlives of your temporary projects, particularly in the most literal case of the homing pigeons.
Sure. Well, the homing pigeons went back to the group that worked with us, and they became breeding pigeons. So oftentimes they'll have, like, you know, they'll have this cycle of pigeons who go from racers to breeders. So that was the agreement from the get-go, was that they would turn into breeders. Yeah. And they pair up, so, you know, when they're hanging out a lot, they very quickly, monogamously pair up. Yeah, it's so, quite sweet. And, you know, we had, like, yeah, we'd name for the couples, and yeah, so we made sure, like, couples had to, I don't know, I think, I'm pretty sure the museum made sure the couples weren't split up. That would be awful.
Are you at all worried that your Iranian project is going to attract the same kind of opposition that your Palestinian project?
Yeah, interestingly enough, we focused on Iran at Conflict Kitchen already, and not a peep. A little bit, but no, I'm not. I'm not. I mean, and if it does, then that's basically a pre-existing condition. I did a project in city of Columbus, Ohio, which was a time and temperature sign. It told the live time and temperature of Tehran. It said Tehran, Iran, and it had the live time and temperature. And it was sort of wrong for Columbus, but it was right for Tehran. But it was, and it was totally innocuous, but it was obviously not. It was during the last presidential election. And some people were very angry about it, this time and temperature sign. So, in many ways, it's just functioning as a kind of social mirror of conditions that pre-exist, and I'm not unaware of that. And I think sometimes that's important for art to tease those things out. Is that?
Yeah.
Thank you, Jon. Thank you.